So today we are very fortunate that we are having His Grace Shamik Rishi Prabhuji to enlighten us on Srimad Bhagavatam. So Prabhuji, are you present on the call?
Yes, Mataji, I'm on the call.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, please accept our humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada and Guru Maharaj. Thank you so much Prabhuji for giving your valuable association. So now you can take over the class Prabhuji. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. My humble obeisances to all the kind Vaishnavas who are joining this japa session. So we'll be reading Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 4, Chapter 2, from text number 21 to 26. That Daksha curses Lord Shiva. That is the name of the topic. Please accept my humble obeisances. Vancha kalpataru bhesya, karpa sendho bhevacha, patita nam pavanebhyo, vaishnavebhyo namo nama, nama om vishnu padaya, krishna prishthaya bhutale, shrimate bhakti vedanta swaminiti namine, namaste sarasvate deve, gauravani pracharine, nirvishesha, shunyavadi, pashyatya deshatarine, sri krishna chaitanya, prabhu nityananda, shri advaita gadadhar srivasadi, gaur bhakta vrinda. Hare krishna, hare krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So these discussions are that today's topic, although it is Daksha was cursing Lord Shiva, but it is Nandishwar, that after Lord Shiva left, and Daksha initially cursed Lord Shiva because he did not stand up for in honor of Daksha, which is Daksha is his younger brother also. In one sense, although he was his son-in-law, but both are Brahma's son. Although Lord Shiva is beyond even Brahma's son, he is the supreme personality of Godhead. His position is completely different. But Daksha, being a materialistic, did not understand the position of Lord Shiva, and he became very angry, and he was saying ill words about Lord Shiva. Then later on, Lord Shiva left. He did not speak a word. And that is the position, that if somebody, a Vaishnava, is offended in this way and they do not speak a word, that's very, very dangerous. And that same thing happened with King Rahugan. And King Rahugan and Jad Bharat. So Jad Bharat, King Rahugan was saying slandering words for Jad Bharat. He did not speak at all, but when he said some words, the first time that he spoke, otherwise he was acting as a deaf, dumb, mute, like he would not respond to anything. Anybody even caught him just to go and be sacrificed. He did not take any action, did not speak a word, why you are killing me, but the Kali herself appeared when he was being sacrificed. In this way, there are many, many instances in the Bhagavatam that if one Vaishnava is offended and he does not speak, if he also starts counter-cursing or speaking against or at least taking some action, then that is not as dangerous as if somebody does not speak. Like Garudji was refused by this muni who was underneath the water. He was meditating, but then he cursed Garudji, that any time you come, then you will become, it would be your death. And that way the Kaliya took shelter because of that curse to Garud. Kaliya took shelter, and not only all the fishes were died in that, and Kaliya the... So advanced Vaishnava should never be curse, should never be talk ill, should never, one should not speak very like in a cursing way or in a very, very loud way, and that is what has happened, that Lord Shiva did not speak. But Nandishwar, out of revenge, like he started speaking. So these are the Nandishwar, that verses that we are reading today would be Nandishwar. That's why I'm taking up to 26 verse, that now the Nandishwar is speaking. And after 26 verse, it would be Bhrigu, who was associated with Daksha, then he started speaking. So the first verse, the text number 21, ya etan martyam mudishya bhagavatya pratidruhi druhatya agyah prathak drastis tatvato vimukho bhavet. Anyone who has accepted Daksha as the most important personality and neglected Lord Shiva because of envy is less intelligent, and because of visualizing in duality will be bereft of transcendental knowledge. Purport. The first curse of Nandishwar was that anyone supporting Daksha was foolishly identifying himself with the body, and therefore, because Daksha had no transcendental knowledge, supporting him would deprive one of transcendental knowledge. Because we are not the body, we are the spirit soul. But that is his curse, that one would think that he is the body and he will just try to enjoy the body, decorate the body and forget about the spiritual aim. Daksha, Nandishwar said, identified himself with the body like other materialistic persons and was trying to derive all kinds of facilities in the relationship with the body. He had excessive attachment for the body and in relation to the body with wife, children, aham mameti, like yesterday was talked. So that's what he was attached to his wife, children, home and other such things which are different from the soul. It has nothing to do with the soul. Therefore, Nandishwar's curse was that anyone who supported Daksha would be bereft of transcendental knowledge of the soul and thus also be deprived of knowledge of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So that was his first curse. The next verse, Graheshu Kuta Dharmeshu Shakto Gramya Sukhechaya Karma Tantram Vitanute Vedavada Vipannadihi. Pretentiously religious householder's life in which one is attracted to material happiness and thus also attracted to the superficial explanation of the Vedas robs one of all intelligence and attaches one to fruitive activities in all cases. So that was his second curse. That Nandishwar, the first one was that they would not understand that body is different than the soul. Soul has nothing to do with the body. So one would be in the bodily concept of life. And second, that even if they are pretentiously, they think that they are the householder and they are following Varnashram Dharma, but it would not be really the real Varnashram. It would be they will be attracted to the flowery language of the Vedas and not to the real purport of the Vedas, and their intelligence would be for use to gain some fruity activity. So persons we identify with bodily existence are attached to the fruity activities described in the Vedic literature. For example, in the Vedas, it is said that one who observes the Chaturmasya vow will attain eternal happiness in the heavenly kingdom. Purpose of Chaturmasya is not to go to heavenly kingdom, but to worship Supreme Personality of Godhead and go back home, not to go to heavenly kingdom. In Bhagavad Gita, it is said that this flowery language of the Vedas mostly attract persons who identify with the body. To them, such happiness is that of the heavenly kingdom is everything. They do not know that beyond that is the spiritual kingdom or kingdom of God, and they have no knowledge that one can go there. Thus, they are bereft of transcendental knowledge. Such persons are very careful in observing the rules and regulations of household life in order to be promoted to next life, to the moon or other heavenly planets. It is stated here that such persons are attached to Gramya Sukha, which means material happiness, without knowledge of the eternal, blissful spiritual life. So that is the second curse. The Daksha has accepted now text number 23. Daksha has accepted the body as all in all. Therefore, since he has forgotten the Vishnu Pad or Vishnu Gati and attached to sex life only, within a short time he will have the face of a goat. So that was the third curse, that he is so much attached to the sex life and to woman without understanding the real purpose of human life. So he should get, he is like acting as a goat. So he should have a goat's face. So those who have become, the text number 24, those who have become as dull as matter by cultivating materialistic education and intelligence are nascently involved in fruitive activities. Such men have purposely insulted Lord Shiva. May they continue in the cycle of repeated birth and death. So that is his another curse, that they remain perpetually in the material world. These fruitive activities means for the fruits, to enjoy the fruits of one's hard work. The fruit of the one's hard work should be meant to satisfy Krishna, not for sense gratification. But these people would be that they want to get the fruitive results. We should be like not sakam bhakta, and they are not even bhaktas. They just worship demigods, take the fruitive language of the Vedic Shastra, and they are karmakandis. Karmakandi are different than karma yogis. So the three curses mentioned above are sufficient to make one as dull as a stone, void of spiritual knowledge, and preoccupied with materialistic education, which is nascent, After uttering these curses, Nandishwar then cursed the Brahmanas to continue in the cycle of birth and death because of their supporting Daksha in blaspheming Lord Shiva. So 25 and 26, so 25 translation, may those who are envious of Lord Shiva, being attracted by the flowery language of the enchanting Vedic promises and who have thus become dull, always remain attached to fruitive activity. There are different Shastra, six are in mode of patience, goodness, ignorance, passion. So six of this Puranas, but people are attached to the flowery language of the Vedas and they keep them in a fruitive activities. That is just to attract the people to the Vedas. And then there is a real substance, but people, they just remain in that flowery language and they attain all the enjoyment of this material life in a higher way or in a superior way. And that's why there was a king, he said that people who could see him within 20 minutes, then they will become the king of his kingdom. But he arranged so much gardens and women and so many pleasures and so many plays, and people were attracted to those things and they forgot their time that they had to reach to the king in 20 minutes, and they were bereft of taking the position of the king. So this is also with us also, that we could get the pleasure of all the, our father Krishna is waiting in the spiritual kingdom in Golok Vrindavan and waiting for us to come and enjoy, take inheritance of all this. But we are attached to this shortcomings in the material world, attached to the attraction in the material world, and forget to go back home, back to Godhead. And that's why we suffer. So the Vedic promises of elevation to higher planets for a better standard of materialistic life are compared to flowery language, because in the flower there is certainly an aroma, but that aroma does not last for a very long time. In a flower there is honey, but that honey is not eternal. The last verse is sarvabhaksha dvijavratyai dhrata vidyata povrata vitta dehendriya rama yachaka vicharantviha. These brahmanas take to education, austerity and vows only for the purpose of maintaining the body. They shall be devoid of discrimination between what to eat and what not to eat. They will acquire money, begging from door to door, simply for the satisfaction of the body. So these were the different curses were given. The third curse inflicted by Nandishwar on the brahmanas who supported Daksha is completely functioning in the age of Kali. The so-called brahmanas are no longer interested in understanding the nature of the Supreme Brahman. They don't want to know who is Krishna, what is our relationship, how we could obtain him. Although a brahmana means one who has attained the knowledge about Brahman. In the Brahman means the Krishna. In Vedanta Sutra also it is said, Atato Brahma Jigyasa. This human form of life is meant for realization of the Supreme Brahman, the Absolute Truth. Or in other words, human life is meant for one's elevation to the post of Brahman. Unfortunately, here Brahman means Vaishnava. Unfortunately, the modern Brahmanas are so-called Brahmanas who come in originally Brahminical families have left their own occupational duties. But they do not allow others to occupy the post of Brahmanas. The qualification for Brahmanas are described in the scriptures, in Srimad Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita and all other Vedic literature. Brahmana is not a hereditary title or position. If someone from a non-Brahman family, for example, one born in a family of Shudras, tries to become a Brahman by being properly qualified under the instruction of a bona fide spiritual master, these so-called Brahmanas will object. Such Brahmanas, having been cursed by Nandishwar, are actually in a position where they have no discrimination between eatables and non-eatables. Many Brahmanas, they eat fish and meat also and drink and take any kind of job and simply live to maintain the perishable material body and its family. Such fallen conditioned souls are not worthy to be called Brahmanas. But in Kali Yuga, they claim to be Brahmanas, and if a person actually tries to attain the Brahminical qualification, they try to hinder his progress. just like Srila Prabhupada's movement was also hindered. Many Brahmanas said that how you are giving initiation to Mlechhas and Yavanas and so this is the situation in the present age. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu condemned this principle very strongly. During his conversation with Ramananda Rai, he said that regardless of whether a person is born in a Brahmin family or Shudra family, regardless of whether he is a householder or a sannyasi, if he knows the science of Krishna, he must be a spiritual master. Jai Krishna Tattva Vetta Sai Guru Hai. Kiva Vipra Kiva Nyasi Shudra Kene Nai. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had many so-called Shudra disciples like Haridas Thakur and Ramananda Rai. Even the Goswamis who were principal students of Lord Chaitanya were also ostracized from Brahman society. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu by his grace made them first-class Vaishnavas. Om Ajnanti Mirandashya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurum Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Nama. So these are instructive verses. So this we read from 21 to 26. Nandishwar curses Daksha. So just in nutshell, and his followers. So Nandishwar, after Daksha, Prajapati, cursed Lord Shiva. Means very harsh language, very, very harsh way. Curse means not that directly you become this, but that was his all meaning, not in a respectful way. So now the Nandi became very angry. He was infected by anger. Nandishwar counter-cursed Daksha, who had tolerated Daksha's cursing Shiva. So those curses, the first one would be, they would be bereft of the knowledge. Anyone who has supported Daksha and neglected Lord Shiva is less intelligent because of his vision of duality. Duality means bodily identification. That body is spirit soul, they don't understand. They just think that yes, body and spirit, and body is what is me, and I should enjoy to the fullest extent. They will be bereft of transcendental knowledge of the soul and the Lord. That what is the soul and its relation with the Lord. So that is the first curse. Then there is a second curse, pretentious religious householder life, in which one is attached to material happiness. They will think that they are religious, but they are not religious. They don't even understand what is the religion. So one is attached to the material happiness and thus attracted to the superficial explanation of the Vedas. Veda Vadarati. It robs one of the intelligence and fully attached one to Karma Kanda. Greshu Kutak Dharmeshu Shakto Gramya Sukhechaya Karma Tantram Vitanute Veda Vada Vipanna Diha. So that was that they will be, means pseudo-religious householder life. First, they will be bereft of the knowledge. Second would be pseudo-religious householder life. The third, that let Daksha, who has forgotten Vishnu Gati, the spiritual goal, is to be attached to sex life, very shortly have the head of a goat. So that was his third curse. And then, also that he cursed at the same time that they will continue in the sansar. Persons dulled by materialistic education and with minds attracted to the flowery language of Vedas have purposely insulted Lord Shiva. May Daksha's followers continue in sansar. Sansar means repeated birth and death. Again going to the mother's womb, taking so many bodies, 8.4 million species of life. That is sansar, and always remain attached to the fruitive activities. So, and then the last one this Nandishwar curse, that they will lose discrimination. Let these Brahmanas take to education, austerity and vows only for the purpose of maintaining the body. They shall be devoid of discrimination in eating. Let them become beggars simply for the satisfaction of the body. So Nandishwar's curse is still standing. It is really meant for this Kali Yuga. The Brahmanas are functional in Kali Yuga. So curse was given long time ago, but now it is affecting all the so-called caste Brahmanas in this Kali Yuga. So that is the dangerous effect of being within the range of uncontrolled anger. So there was anger even by Nandishwar also, and it is not really right. One may say that should he do that? So there were three conditions that if somebody is blaspheming a Vaishnava, either one should pull his tongue, or they should also not really counter cursing, that is not the thing, but they should argue with him that what they are saying is completely wrong, or they should go away. But not, the Shastra does not say that one should become angry and curse, counter curse and fight. That is not the right way. So material field is so unsteady that even personalities like Nandishwar, Daksha and many of the brahmanas present were infected by the atmosphere of anger. So that anger should not have been there. So this is all the effect of maya, that one comes in the sway of anger and destroys their spiritual path. So this is, so just little bit about the, how the kick of maya works. And so there was, so we will tell few stories that Srila Prabhupada used to say. So kick of maya means maya allures us that, oh, I will enjoy and it is very nice. So there is a alluring potency of the maya and covering potency of the maya. So there was a washerman who had a donkey, and donkey are very lazy by nature. So to keep, like, he had a lot of load of weight cloths, so he thought that how to make him work. So he put a bamboo and tied it to the neck and the body of the, and then put some grass, green grass, on the 1 foot away from the donkey. So donkey thought that I will just walk and eat this grass. So he will go on, but with the stick, the grass was also moving. And that way he would work very, very hard and never to get that grass at any time. And same thing, maya is acting for us and making us believe that there is a happiness by doing this, that, but that happiness never come. So maya is presenting material allurement to the living entity, and which is like a bundle of green grass. So in material world, we work very, very hard to be happy, but nobody gets real happiness. Real happiness is anandam buddhi vardhanam, that it increases at every step. So more they work, the further happiness gets away. So whole life and life after life that we are working, that yes, very hard under the spell of maya. So this is how maya makes us foolish of everyone in the material world. Fools of everyone. So everyone is getting foolish because of the maya's allurement. And we should not get under the sway of maya. We should understand that material body is just an instrument to serve the Supreme Lord. And we are Krishna Das. So by eternal our inheritance we will obtain by serving Krishna, not by serving maya. Maya would kick us and keep us in the darkness of the material world. And we will suffer the threefold miseries, adi devik, adi bhautik, adhyatmik. So donkey works whole day under the illusion that very soon he will get the green grass. But at the end of the day, the donkey goes home to the she-donkey and hoping to enjoy with her. But the she-donkey kicks him in the face. I have seen many donkeys, and he and she donkeys, and their eyes were like broken or pierced by the hard kicks of the she donkey. The donkeys tries to enjoy her. In the same way, the living entities are working hard, running after maya, and then the maya never stops kicking the living entities. They do not understand, but just continue running after maya's allurement. Just like the donkey keeps running after its mat, even after getting kicked in the face so many times. So we are getting the kicks of maya. So Prabhupada used to say this in a very, very nice way. This material life, that is a prison, house of material existence. Like one may, this material world is a prison house. One may say that he is enjoying in the material world. So it is like a golden shackle or a golden chain, but he is tied, he is not free. The second class, they are, may have a silver chain, but still they are in prison. And third with a iron chain, but whether it is iron chain. So one who is thinking, oh, I am very happy, I have a golden chain, why I should worry about a silver chain? But no, none of this, all these are concoction. Freedom means in the spiritual world, we go and enjoy with Krishna. But the material world, we have no freedom, are very minimal. Just like a cow is tied to a wooden pole, 20 feet rope. So he could move up to 20 feet, but not beyond that. So we are hunted by a ghost. Mayar biche khacha hub, habu dubu bhai. So this maya is tying, like say, a prince has been hunted by a ghost. And then that ghost, he acts like that haunted man, does not really disrupts everything and creates a lot of havoc in the kingdom. But he is still the son of the king, prince. But after a cure, means he even beats his father, mother, everybody. But later on, by a Vaidya, he becomes corrected, and then he behaves very, very properly. But he was a king, so we are children of God, Krishna Das. So, but we have forgotten that we are Krishna Das. Now we have become Maya Das. So by a spiritual master who is like a Vaidya, a real Vaidya, can cure his disease of Maya and could remove this ghost called Maya. And then we would act properly. Wherever we go in this world, in the name of dharma, is acting cheating. This is the true, because all this so-called dharma keeps the living entity trapped within it. That is also material. Dharma, artha, kama, moksha. So that's why there is a story in Upakhyane, Updeshe, by Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Maharaj, that, so there was like a king and his assistant, prime minister, and commander-in-chief. So they thought to go and attack the another king. And also he had the same three people, the king, the prime minister, and commander-in-chief. So they fought and they won the next-door kingdom. But their children, while the fighting was going on, the children of these all the three, the sons of all the three, they went to the kingdom of the first king. And then there were three girls of these three personalities, the king, the minister, and the commander-in-chief. And they allured them, and then they want to get married, and they were ultimately got married from this. So now when this king, after winning, he becomes very much disturbed. So they ordered that boys should be arrested. And then they arrested him. The judgment was that son of chain, the son of the prime minister would be shackled by the silver chain, and the son
Hare Krishna, we cannot hear you properly. Can anyone hear Prabhu?
No, we cannot hear him.
I think he got dropped.
Hello?
Yeah, Hare Krishna.
Yeah, we got cut. I will redial again, okay?
No, no, I can't hear Prabhuji. Prabhuji, you are there.
Oh, I'm there. Okay, thank you. So, I was telling this story that one king attacked to the another kingdom, but these boys of this another king, they were attached to the girls there, and they get married, and when they come, they become very furious. So they were tied up with a golden chain. The son of the king, the son of the prime minister, was shackled with a silver chain, and the son of the commander-in-chief was chained with the iron chain. So they think it's a very nice, but it is not really. All our three are tied and they are in the prison house. So in the material world, maybe very rich or one maybe middle class or maybe poor, but they are all tied up tight into the rope, three ropes called the modes of material nature. So this material world is compared to a prison, and the prison house of material existence, and nobody could be happy in a prison. So those chains may be made of gold or that is like goodness, or silver like the mode of passion, or iron that is mode of ignorance, but they are all chains nonetheless. The purpose of life is to not remain shackled by golden chain and stay in the material world in a apparent comfort. The purpose of life is to get out of this prison, the prison house of this material existence. Prabhupada used to also talk about the dark veil of material existence. So they enjoy the flickering happiness and forget their real problem or real purpose of human life. But Lord is very, very merciful, and he sends a rope in the form of Vedic knowledge, so that by that help of that rope, they could get out of the bhavakoop. Bhavakoop means a dark veil of material existence. So once a man, he was walking through a forest, and then at one point he did not really, because of the darkness, to his negligence, he fell into the dry well. But while he was falling, then he saw like there was a rope. So he caught hold of a rope, and he was saved from falling into the bottom of the well. And so he was hanging in the middle of the well, holding desperately to the rope. So men thought, oh, at least I am fortunate that I am saved today. If I had fallen to the bottom, then I would have been died. So he was just thinking that way, and then he looked up and he saw that there is a tiger opening his mouth, sitting, and he's waiting that when he comes up, I will devour him. So he was decided that he would not go up, but then when he saw down, he thought that I will go down. So there he saw a python who was very hungry and was waiting for the man to come. So he could not go down, he could not come up either because of the fear of his death. Then after some time he was hanging, then he saw that there are two rats are cutting that rope by which he is hanging, a black rat and a white rat. And later on that he saw that it could cut and he will just fall and will die if he just falls down. So then there was on the top of the tree, then there was a honeycomb and some drops of honey were there. So honey was falling on his head and then he turned his face in a way that it falls in his mouth. So he was very happy and he forgot his precarious condition. So in this way, completely forgot his predicament at what is happening. So the rope which represents our this finite life, that it could break any time. The rats are day and the night. They are black and white. They are day and night. So that is, and the python's mouth, that is the jaws of the death. And so we are all getting close to the jaws of the death. And one day we will die. The tiger at the top is that represents the liberation, which a devotee fears more than death itself. Because liberation means that there is no seva. Seva to the Lord. So that Sahija Mukti is also not good. So that lion or tiger is liberation. The python downstairs, down part, that is the death person. So that is the death. The day and night are cutting our days and one can break and fall, pray. But just for enjoying a flickering happiness of that honey drops, we think my position is nice. So that is the position of all the materialistic people. So much being curious, we are busy enjoying material family life. This kind of enjoying is like the drops of the honey. We are so busy enjoying this family life that we do not care and recognize that that one day would come, passing the day, and that will bring closer to the death. The rope of our life span is getting thinner and thinner, and at any time we may fall into the bottom of the well and be devoured by the python of death. So this is our ignorance. So what we can do? That is by taking the knowledge of the scripture, and then the Lord sends, he comes himself, he sends his devotees, he sends his scriptures, Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, he sent in so many ways that we can be saved if we catch hold of the lotus feet of the Lord and pray to him, and he will liberate him. So out of ignorance we are mistaking this suffering for a place of enjoyment. This material world, there is no happiness. Dukkhalayam Ashashvatam, Lord has labeled that, but we think it is very, very nice. So that is the, Srila Prabhupada used to say this story, that is the dark well of material existence, that we are in this Andhakoop. Andhakoop means Maya Mugdha Jivir Nahi, Swatat Krishna Gyan, Jivir Krapaya Kaila Krishna Veda Puran. That is out of mercy that he told us, gave us this Veda Puran. So Krishna has given us all this. But we by ourselves, although we are Krishna Das, Krishna Das, ye vishwas kar leta aur dukha nahi. He jeev. So we are Krishna Das. But if we know that, and then through this scripture, Ved Puran, then we could become free. The conditioned soul cannot revive his Krishna consciousness by his own effort. But out of causeless mercy, Lord Krishna compiled a Vedic literature, and it's a supplement. And so Srila Prabhupada is writing, a conditioned soul is bewildered by the world's illusory energy, Maya. So Maya's business is to keep the conditioned soul forgetfulness of our real relationship with Krishna. So living entity, we forget the real identity that we are Krishna Das, a spirit soul, Brahman, and instead of realizing the spiritual position, he wants to enjoy his senses. Which we are not. We are not the senses. We are the body is made of senses, grouped together in such a way that we feel that I am the body. So due to his external energy, the living entity, although transcendental to the three modes of material nature, thinks himself as a material product and thus undergo the reactions of material miseries. So this is Maya, how the Maya act on the conditioned soul, thinking himself the product of the material energy. So in this way we get trapped up, and Shastra is telling us in so many ways. Bhaja Hure Mana Shri Nandanandana Abhaya Charanaravindale Durlabha Manava Janma Satsange Taroha E Bhava Sindhure. That Mano Jivan is very, very hard to get, and he, so this song is so nice. Sita Atapa Vata Parijana Edina Jamini Jagire Pipale Sevanu Krapana Durjana Chapala Sukhalava Lagire. Day and night I remain sleepless, suffering heat and cold, wind and rain for a bit of flickering happiness. I have vainly served wicked and miserly man. Edana Yavana Putra Parijana Itheki Ache Paratiti Re Kamala Dala Jala Jivana Talamala Bajahu Haripada Niti Re. So there is no assurance of the real happiness in this with this wealth, youthfulness, sons, family members. This life is tottering like a drop of water on the lotus petal. So we should always serve and worship the divine feet of Lord Hari. Shravana, and those are the nine processes of devotional service. Srila Prabhupada also told that the tree of material existence. So it is, Lord Krishna is instructing Uddhava about the sattva, the 11th canto. The material body is sansar taru, sansar vraksha, the tree of material existence. The like a tree produces fruits, the material body produces the various of the material existence. So the tree like produces, so just like a cloth. You know, what is a cloth? Ohan cloth, expansion of lengthwise and crosswise threads. So the entire universe is expanded on the lengthwise and crosswise potency of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and is situated within him. Conditioned soul has been accepting material bodies since time immemorial. So we are anadikal, but not anantha time. We will be good and by taking shelter of Krishna. So sansar taru, we are wandering up and down heavenly planet, lower planets in the material world, just like a monkey is jumping up and down. But our real place is the spiritual kingdom, where we could be happy forever, not by going up or down, not by going to the heavenly planet or higher planetary system. We cannot be happy. That is not the way it has been created. So one should use the sharp axe of knowledge to sever one's connection to the material bondage. So knowledge is the one. With steady intelligence, you should develop unalloyed devotional service and worship the spiritual master and Lord Krishna. And with the sharpened axe of transcendental knowledge, we should cut off the subtle material covering of the soul. So we have this subtle and grass covering, and we can cut it off. Upon realizing the Supreme Personality of Godhead, you should then give up the axe of analytic knowledge. So Srila Prabhupada is writing, one can achieve pure devotional service by worshipping a bona fide spiritual master. One should never give up pure devotional service or one's spiritual master. Rather, it is clearly stated here that one should cultivate knowledge of the material world as described by Lord Krishna. One should fully understand. So that is how these all the instructions are there for us. And how all these things, one should fully understand that each and every aspect of this material creation is the expansion of the illusory potency of the Lord. Such knowledge works as a sharpened axe to cut down the roots of material existence. In this way, even the stubborn subtle body created by the three modes of nature is cut to pieces, and one becomes apramat or sane, and then he takes to Krishna consciousness. This is the river of material nature. The river of the material nature. His spiritual world is never created or annihilated. This material nature, the river flows up and down, upward and downward. River that flows both ways. That is the river of the material. Up means going higher planet, down means going to the hellish planet. So river flows both ways. The spiritual world is never, but the spiritual world is never created or annihilated. Anadi karma phale, that we are getting this from anadi kal. So this is, we are in the forest of the material existence. So in material existence there are ferocious animals, and so we are going deeper and deeper, and so we face, it means there are so many animals, so much python, so much thars, so we are also facing all that. So material forest, and Sukadeva Goswami has very nicely described in Srimad Bhagavatam. So there is a direct meaning and indirect meaning of this. Nana Yoni Sadafire. Krishna Bahirmukh Hana Bhogavancha Kare Nana Yoni Sadafire Kadarya Bhakshana Kare Tar Janma Adha Pate Yaya. His whole life is spoiled. So if we want to get out of this material world and want to be free from material entanglement and fulfill the real purpose of human life, then we should take to the Sadhu, Shastra, Guru and Sarva Krishna, and this way we could be free from the temporary enjoyment of, in the material world. In other words, in the forest it looks very nice in the beginning, but then when we get trapped, then it's very difficult to get out of that forest. So we are gone very, very deep and forgot our way, but some Sadhu may come and give us the, show us the real way, and if we could follow, then rather than becoming adamant that, oh, I don't want to listen to you, I know my path. No, we don't know. And we have been moving in the material world for long, for millions and billions of lifetimes. So we could be free by taking the direction from Sadhu, Shastra and Guru. So thank you so much. We talked about this Daksha Prajapati, how the Daksha cursed Lord Shiva, and then there was a counter-cursing, which was also not right by Nandishwar. And the reason, the beyond that, it's all because of the Kali Yuga. Kali Yuga had to come, and the Brahmana had to be bereft of all this spiritual knowledge, and they are misleading the people, and many people fall, they think that they are the only source of knowledge, and everybody should listen to them. But source of knowledge is Sadhu, the who is practicing Vaishnava, and then it should be taken from the Shastra. And so Shastra Chakshu we should look, not by just bogus sadhus or bogus gurus. We should discriminate who is real and who is not, and that needs some real desire. So main thing that if our desire is to get out of the material world, then Krishna would send a proper Brahmanda Brahmite Kaun, Bhagyavan Jeev, Guru Krishna Prasade Pai, Bhakti Lata Bi. So the seed would be sown if that our desire is pure to go back home, back to Godhead. Hare Krishna, so you can unmute and we can discuss. So it's nice topics, and we talked in a different way, counter-cursing and how, what is the meaning, what is this Maya. So that is all anger was under the influence of Maya. And the Brahmanas became bereft of all the knowledge in this Kali Yuga. Means they have to become a Vaishnava, not just by caste Brahman.
Yes. Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dandav Pranam, Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Guru Maharaj ki jai, very, very wonderful class, Prabhuji. Prabhuji, I have a question. At the beginning, you speak about Kaliya. So I did not understand who cursed who in that.
There were Nandishwar is cursing. That is the beginning that all the verses up to 26 that I read, it is about Nandishwar cursing Daksha and all the Brahmanas who were associating with Daksha. So that was the curse. And those three curses that you want to know, what was the three curses that were given by Nandishwar?
Yes.
That's what is your... Yeah. So he is counter-cursing. After Daksha curse, then he is counter-cursing. And that they will be bereft of the knowledge. That is one thing, because they will bear it to the knowledge means that we are the spirit soul, part and parcel of Krishna, and we are not the material bodies. That identification, they will forget. They will think that just to make the body fat, the body means the senses, let the senses enjoy. Yavat jivet, sukham jivet, rinam kratva, ghratam pivet. So that is the first thing. And then the religious household life that they will become, they will become attached to the material happiness. And superficial explanation, like they will take to flowery language of the Veda, that is Karmakand. So people would become bereft of the real knowledge that they are part of Krishna. Then they will take to the Smriti activity, karma kand, that is the second curse. The third one was that he will get a goat's body and would be attached to sex life. So that is the third curse, and then they will remain in the sansar by not following the Vedic literature. They will remain in the sansar, and then they will lose discrimination. Just no austerity, nothing, only for the purpose of maintaining the body. So their vows are just, they will take austerity not for to please Krishna. They will take austerities to enjoy. Like many people, they work so hard like an ass. But the purpose is not just to enjoy. Like, so we talked about it, how one gets trapped by different stories that I was narrating later on. So these were the curses that Nandishwar gave. And because of his curse, that curse is affecting now in Kali Yuga. All the Brahmanas, they are not really Vaishnavas, and they are do any kind of work, eat anything, and does not follow the real Vedic system of pleasing Krishna, but pleasing their senses. They lost their intelligence.
Yes, Prabhuji. So, Prabhuji, why these Brahmanas are getting affected in this? Nandishwar is supposed to be cursing Daksha Prajapati, right?
No, but also there were so many Brahmanas were siding, like Bhrigu and others. They were siding with Daksha, so he cursed all of them, not just Daksha, but anybody who, in the yagya. There are all so many Brahmanas were there.
Yeah.
So they were also part of the curse. So curse that affected, that curse affected all the Brahmanas also. So now they are poor. They beg, they eat anything, they have no spiritual knowledge. Although Prabhupada comes from a Kayastha family, but he liberated so many people. Kayastha family is like compared to like a Shudra. According to what the Brahmanas they think. But he alone, the Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he's also like taken birth in a Kayastha family. So it is not by birth, it is by what is their understanding of Krishna and how they could liberate so many other people.
Hare Krishna, can I ask a question?
Yes, sure.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dhanwat Pradhan. Thank you very much. Prabhuji, I had this question on related to the first verse of Nectar of Instruction, where it says, Vacho Vegam Mansa Krodha Vegam, and in the end it says, Yetan Veganya Vishayeta Dira Sarvam Apimam Prithvinsa Shishya. So, I was trying to understand that here Rupa Goswami is telling that we have to control all these senses, tongue, anger. And then in the end he says that if someone controls that, then he can have disciples all over the world.
Right.
So, whereas in Shikshashtakam we see that na dhanam, na janam, na sundaram, pavitam. We don't want any followers or anything. So how can I understand both the things? Are we doing it for followers or when we don't want anything like?
See, we have to understand that it's a proper perspective that one can have all the disciples if you follow. So that is the qualification of a guru or who has controlled six Vedas. Six Vedas, if one can control, they could have, and then this, but he is not attached to all this. When it says, na dhanam, na janam, na sundarim, kavitam, va jagdish kame, mama janmani, janmanishware, bhautad, bhaktir, ahetu kitavi. So he does, but it is for devotional service to Krishna that he wants to liberate. In Bhagavad Gita also it says that if you could preach others in Krishna consciousness and lift them from downfall, because they are also children. So he does act as a servant of Krishna. So that is also a devotional service. Becoming a spiritual master and serving is taking a role of a servant of Krishna to liberate those people. Like the one should not become a guru or wife or husband or like leader if they cannot liberate. Means if they rot in the material world and then suffer in the material world perpetually, it is better that they take that position and give them proper knowledge about Krishna, and they could relate. So sambandha gyan Bhagwan ka jo hai, unhe dena. So these are not contradictory things. He is doing it for service to Krishna.
Okay.
not for his glorification, not that they are meant for him or his service. It is the duty of the disciple to serve the spiritual master, but that is our duty, just so he could continue by his helping him, he could continue his devotional service to Krishna. So one is that, what is the qualification? The first, the Vacha Vegam Manasa Krodha Vegam, that is giving the qualification of a guru, that he could make all the disciples. And other one, that he should not be attached to, should not be really attached to, that there should be disciple, they should serve for his pleasure. No, it is for pleasure of Krishna, that is asking them to serve. Prabhupada engaged everybody in doing some service, but that is for pleasure of Krishna, so he could spread Krishna consciousness. There is no contradiction. Hello?
Yes, yes, Guruji. Yeah. Thank you, Guruji, that answers. Yes.
Okay, bro. Okay. Now, it's a big topic. We could discuss more about why Vaishnava like Prabhupada or all the different gurus, they need certain disciples to serve them, so he could serve Krishna. He does not take it for his glorification. Prabhupada always said that these are disciples of my Guru Maharaj, and his Guru Maharaj gives credit to his Guru Maharaj. That way ultimately it is Krishna. So the devotees who serve a guru, that is, they are serving Krishna, not particular person's sense of gratification. And Krishna wants not that it is real service, otherwise what everybody would be doing? How they could serve Krishna directly, in what way? His apta kam. So you serve his one who is serving Krishna. So he could preach and he could spread Krishna consciousness.
Yes,
sir,
yes.
Akela chana bhaar nahi phod sakta. मतलब अकेले चने से नहीं होगा, इट हैज टू बी सो मेनी. तो भट्टी में डालते हैं ना, सो देयर इज सो मेनी, चना हैज टू बी देयर. द सेम थिंग दैट देयर हैज टू बी, लाइक प्रभुपाद अलोन कुड नॉट डू मच इन इंडिया, बट हियर पीपल अंडरस्टूड, ही टुक दैट, दे टुक इट वेरी सीरियसली, एंड सर्व श्रील प्रभुपाद मोर देन देयर ऑन लाइफ, एंड प्रभुपाद कुड शो ऑल द बिग रिजल्ट बिकॉज ऑफ दैट, दैट दे वेर सरेंडर्ड सोल्स.
Thank you very much for wonderful class and given such a nice stories to understand that we are in a three more way, whether it's silver chain or golden chain or copper.
A little louder.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji Dandavat Pranam, all good Srila Prabhupada and Gurudev. Thank you very much for wonderful class and given such a nice explain such a nice story that we are covering with silver rope or copper rope or golden rope, but that is material. We have to surrender ourselves to Lord Krishna and Srimati Radharani. Thank you very much for wonderful class. Wonderful
session. Thank you for letting me know. Thank you. If anyone has any another comment, questions, discussions, please.
Go ahead, Mataji.
Okay. No, Mataji.
Prabhuji, I have one question asking by newcomer, and I also don't know nicely. That why the Shikha is necessary for Prabhuji? Can you please explain?
That is, Prabhupada was also asked that why people have to be bald and keep a shikha. Shikha is a Vaishnava sign that yes, he is a Vaishnava, just like an antenna which could catch the spiritual vibrations easily and clean shaved that brahmacharis and sannyasis, and they keep it clean shaved, so you don't have to put your effort in taking care of the hair. And that is the sign of that, yes, sign of beauty in the Kali Yuga. They have just put there in the nails and hair, and they spend so much time and money and maintaining. So better to renounce hair and just keep a little tuft as a sign of that one is a Vaishnava. Only Vaishnavas keep that Shikha.
Okay.
which acts like an antenna to catch his spiritual sound vibrations.
Gaulok Vrindavan Dham, Prabhu?
It's Gaulok Vrindavan. The sound comes Golokera Premadana Harinamaka Sankirtana. Harinam comes from Gaulok Vrindavan. So by putting that shikha, one can catch those sound vibrations more easily. One can understand it more easily. And it's a simple life. See, like everybody has their dresses, their way of showing. Military man, a doctor puts on apron or a lab coat, or same way that shikha is a, like a kind of part of the body, and also their dress is simpler. Dhoti, shirt, and women wear the sari and cover
Thank
their
you,
head. So these are the sign of a Vaishnavas, okay?
Thank you, Prabhuji.
You're welcome.
Hare Krishna, Saumandaki Mataji, you wanted to say something?
It's okay. Because I thought that you were asking about the curse, about Kaliya.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, yes. The curse was given to Garuda.
And, right.
And because Garuda was taking fishes, eating from that lake in Vrindavan. So then, Sobhari Muni, he was meditating there under the water, and he also, then he was kind of attached to the fishes. So when Garuda was eating those fishes, so then he didn't want them to, Garuda to eat those fishes. So that's why he cursed Garuda. And because Garuda is a devotee, and he curses him, but then still, then he becomes attached. Then he sees the fishes copulating, so he becomes attached, and then he falls down from his position, and he goes to the king and asks for that he wanted to get married. Instead of one, says he married 50 princesses like that. So anyway, so this is the fall down of that Sobhari Muni. So then Kaliya was afraid because he was eating the food for Garuda was left on the side. That's what, so then he would not eat all the serpents. But then Kaliya was eating. So that's why Garuda was chasing him and wanted to kill him. So that's why this curse was there. So Garuda will not come there. So the Kaliya came there and he was residing there and Krishna drove him out. Hare Krishna. That's what I wanted to explain. Hare Krishna. Thank you very much, Prabhuji. Very nice class.
Thank you, Mataji. Thank you, Hare Krishna. Please offer my respectful obeisances to Jai Gaur Sundar Prabhu.
Yeah, he heard it. He's right here.
Oh, he said, Prabhuji, Dandar Pranam, Jai Srila Prabhupada.
Pranam. Yeah. Yeah, he's saying his obeisances. You can see it. I don't know.
Thank you
very much, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Vancha Kalpataru Devcha Kalpasindhu Devcha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo
Namo Namah.